Church. So this is has been kind of the time of year in which we spend a lot of time reviewing, and most of that has already taken place. I know that out there you often wonder just what it is that a pastor does. You know, what does he do all week long, right? I mean, how long does it take us to take him to put together a 20-minute talk? You wish it was just 20 minutes, right? And come ready. It's a pretty sweet deal sometimes. Actually, I think it is a lot of times. And so in the annual reports, I try and talk about some of the other things that take up my time and the different ministries that make up my ministry here in this church and the things that you make possible. And if you didn't pick up a copy of your annual report, they're either in your box or there might be some extra copies on the table in the back. And you can kind of get a picture, a little bit about my ministry. We get a picture of the Apostle Paul's ministry, what it looked like for him, the things he invested his time in his letters, right? So the Apostle Paul traveled. He traveled all across the ancient Roman world and would stop in different cities and begin to introduce the gospel in these different cities. In his second kind of missionary journey, the second city Paul visits is in Thessalonica. And like his first stop in Philippi, the visit in Thessalonica didn't end well. It was really a difficult visit for them. They came under attack by a group of Jewish people who became jealous of the impact that Paul and his fellows were making and began to stir up the town against them. They actually run out of town. Paul, as he looks back on that time of ministry a couple of stops later, begins to wonder just what impact the gospel has made on the people in Thessalonica. It seemed really positive while he was there, but he's kind of having second thoughts, and he's like going, well, I wonder how they're doing. What's happened? Have they held on? You know, are they still following what I taught them? Is it still real in them? What impact has the gospel made? So Paul sends back one of his younger members of his team, Timothy, kind of to make a trip back to check things out there in Thessalonica. And he goes and connects well with the church there and brings a report back. And then Paul responds to Timothy's report with a letter. We call that letter 1 Thessalonians. This first letter to the Thessalonians. He was worried. But the report comes back that the gospel has made an amazing impact, that their witness has grown while their challenges have increased, so has their willingness to pay the price, to be named a follower of Christ. In the second chapter, kind of Paul's letter, as we have divided it up, he begins to respond to some of the things that Timothy has brought back. Let me read for you just those verses we're going to be thinking about this morning. It's in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, the first 12 verses. You know, brothers and sisters, that our visit to you was not without results. We had previously suffered and been treated outrageously in Philippi, as you know, but with the help of our God, we dared to tell you his gospel in the face of strong opposition. For the appeal we make doesn't spring from error or impure motives, nor are we trying to trick you. On the contrary, we speak as those approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. We are not trying to please people, but God who tests our hearts. And you know we never used flattery, nor did we put on a mask to cover up greed. God is our witness. We were not looking for praise from people, not from you or anyone else, even though as apostles of Christ we could have asserted our authority. Instead, we were like young children among you. Just as a nursing mother cares for her children, so we cared for you. Because we loved you so much, we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well. Surely you remember, brothers and sisters, our toil and hardship. We worked night and day in order not to be a burden to anyone while we preached the gospel of God to you. You're witnesses. And so is God, of how holy, righteous, and blameless we were among you who believed. For you know that we dealt with each of you as a father deals with his own children, encouraging, comforting, and urging you to live lives worthy of God who calls you into his kingdom and glory. He writes back and he talks about the impact that the gospel has made, and it describes for us kind of two key pairings that I want to talk about this morning in how that gospel makes such an impact. The gospel of Christ makes its best impact. It makes its greatest influence when two things are combined, both the message and the messenger. Because both the message and the messenger matter in the sharing of the gospel. When Paul writes to them, he says, "Brothers and sisters, we know that our visit to you was not without results. It wasn't a failure. It accomplished what God wanted it to accomplish. It planted enduring seeds in the hearts and lives of the people." And Paul defends kind of himself, his motivations, and he says all those things, right? He makes an appeal that doesn't spring from error, right? He said, "Hey, look, you know, we don't have impure motives." He said, "We're not trying to please people, but God." He says, "We never used flattery. We didn't put on a mask to cover up greed. We're not looking for praise from people, not from you or anyone else." When you listen to kind of those series of, defenses that Paul makes about his activities among them, you might notice that he's not defending the message, right? He's not trying to correct an error in their doctrine. He's not trying to defend the work and the teaching of Jesus. He doesn't come at this stage in this letter talking about the resurrection and its power and proof of who Jesus is. He's talking about, his own practice. Because both the message and the messenger matter. It is in this passage kind of the motivation and the activities of Paul and his fellow workers that's under attack, or at least that he's seeking to defend. Paul knows, and he wants them to know, that motives matter. He shares all this because, he's concerned to provide a good example. And he shares proof of what's going on inside of him, his motivations, things they really couldn't know unless he tells them. He says, "Look, this isn't really honestly why I'm doing what I'm doing. It's none of those things that others might have said." And he knows how important it is. In fact, he already has affirmed that they had caught on. Right? Earlier in the book, he said that they had imitated both us and the Lord. And as a result, they had become an example to all the believers in Greece through both Macedonia and Achaia, which are two major regions, kind of like counties or large counties in Macedonia and Greece. And Paul says, "Look, that's really important that your example, looks like it should." He's careful so they would understand why he was doing the things he was doing. And they became witnesses, and he says it so clearly, "You're witnesses, and so is God, of how holy, righteous, and blameless we were among you who believed." Paul says, "Look, it's really important that you understand my heart," because he wants their hearts to come alongside to be an example of the same thing. If you're like me, it can be really frustrating to, see people claiming to be Christ on one hand and living as though Christ had never had anything to say about how we ought to live. It could be really frustrating. And I was a while ago that someone picked up one of those magazines that have all the Christian businesses in them, right? And people in there saying, "Look, I'm a Christian businessman," and they're clothing themselves in kind of the ethic of Jesus and saying, "Look, I'm dependable, I'm good, I'm a Christian businessman," and then report I get back from them is that, that's not how I thought a Christian businessman ought to act. I thought they'd been very mistreated and that, it hurts, doesn't it? People who claim the name of Jesus, but their motives, their activities, their following of Christ is very different. Frustrating. It's frustrating to see people claim to be Christian and, in their marriage relationship or in their relationship with their friends at school. Just not living out really what it looks like for Christ to be able to say what to do. Really, integrity, honesty, humility, courage, right? Those are what Paul is teaching by his example. He's saying to us, to the people in Thessalonica, be careful to teach the truth, but also don't manipulate other people for personal gain. Don't focus on what people think, but on what pleases God. Both what you say and what you live, they matter. So a few years ago, I read the story of a large church, and for them, parking had become really a difficult issue. In fact, it began to be a bone of contention. People were actually fighting over parking places, right? I got here first. You cut me off. And the parking lot was becoming a really ugly place in the church. So finally, the minister one Sunday had to get up in front of everybody and say, listen, if your walk with God doesn't change how you act in the parking lot, maybe you should find another church because you're messing it up for the rest of us, right? You and I are not just responsible for what we know, we're responsible for what we do. Because how we act provides an example for others to understand who Jesus is. Paul's very careful. He's very careful to provide a good example, and he's concerned that his disciples, the ones that are following him, would provide a good example for the people that are learning from them. Now, later, in another city, Paul would write a letter back to the church in Philippi, a church he visits after Thessalonica and or before Thessalonica, and he's in a different circumstance in that time. This time, Paul is in prison when he writes to the church in Philippi. It's a very difficult time for him. And as he writes to the church in Philippi, he says, hey, look, there are some people that are preaching Christ just to make it more difficult for me while I'm here in prison. And in that time, he said, some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry. But he said, hey, as long as Christ is preached, it's okay with me. Because it wasn't about him personally. But for those that he has influence over, those that he can call to consider what makes the message impact people's lives, it's when both of those things come together. When there's both the messenger and the message on the same page. Paul provides a good example of that. And he does it because he wants their foundation to be secure. He wants them to know that they haven't been tricked or manipulated and to not call into question what they know to be true. Over and over in this letter, do you hear it? He uses that phrase, you know, remember, you witness, all of those kind of things. He's reminding them of what he's already built into them. He wants their foundation secure. He doesn't want to mess with those basic things that they've come to accept and are now being tested in them. He said, you know it's true. You remember what we said. You are witnesses of how we lived among you. He wants their foundation secure. He wants them to be secure in God's work inside of them. And for you and I, we have that word and that activity of God founded on God's word. I've enjoyed the writings of Kate McCord. Kate McCord is a lady who lived for 5 years in Afghanistan, sought to give leadership to a non-governmental organization that was there to bless the people of Afghanistan, to live out her love for Jesus in a really difficult context. And one of the things that she noticed was how different it was for people in Afghanistan than it is here in the States in lots of different ways. One of those is that for us, for you and I, We could easily go down to the bookstore, and just about any bookstore in town, and buy a copy of the Bible. And if we wanted, we could buy a copy of the Quran. It's widely available here in the States. But in Afghanistan, just owning a Bible was, well, illegal and very difficult to acquire. So for them to hear what God had to say was tough. She said this: most Afghans can't get a hold of a printed Bible or even a New Testament. They're illegal and difficult to acquire. Plus, most Afghans either can't read at all or read at such a low level that a printed Bible would be useless to them. But those Afghans who have chosen to share their lives with me have read the Bible in my life and in the stories I've shared. Through our conversations, the perspectives we traded, I introduced my neighbors to Jesus. I told them his teaching and his examples. I revealed what I believed and allowed them to see how I lived. Some watched, listened, and turned away. Others who saw Jesus in my life and my stories found him beautiful and drew his teachings into their hearts, minds, and lives. And I certainly wasn't the only foreigner Christian living in Afghanistan. Afghans met Christian foreigners in their workplaces, their universities, their homes. We attended their weddings and funerals. We drank their tea and ate their salt. We became human. We break down the walls of separation and enter their world. We speak their language, wear their clothes, and begin to understand their culture. We live in their neighborhoods and houses we've rented from them. We have no guns, no tall watchtowers, and no concertina wire to protect ourselves. We ride in taxis, their minibuses, and their rickshaws. We buy our bread from the corner baker and our food, fruits, vegetables, meats, rice, and everything from their local bazaars. Our very presence challenges the power of their teachers and the worldview of our neighbors. It's one thing to hate and reject the voiceless, faceless masses of pig-eating, alcohol-drinking sons of Satan from the other side of the world, mythic characters interpreted by the mullahs through history and religion. But we Christian foreigners are flesh and blood with eyes and voices, laughter and tears, stories and faith. When Afghans meet us, they see our lives, hear our stories, recognize our humanness. Conflicting worldviews collide. The safe box of well-defined ideological fortress orthodoxy trembles. Walls collapse and doors open. But you see, that's not just how we're supposed to live in Afghanistan. Right? That's how we're supposed to live in our world, in our context, in our families, in our workplaces, where what's true about inside of us, we talk about the changes that Jesus makes, find their way into our conversations and the questions we ask and the responses that we give. It flows from a secure foundation where we're willing to expose our hearts and try and explain the reason for the hope that's in us. It's a combination of the message and the messenger that makes the gospel have its intended impact. One other combination that comes to us in this passage is the combination between the source and the connection. We see that often in Scripture, that there's two parts. There's first a reality, a source. There is a one we acknowledge, and then there's one that's at work in us. And Paul demonstrates this. First, he demonstrates this in this courage that he has received from God. He demonstrates courage from God. He tells that story, right, about how we had previously suffered and been treated outrageously in Philippi, as you know, he says, but with the help of our God, we dared to tell you his gospel in the face of strong opposition. And they'd received courage from God to act boldly. And God is acknowledged as the source of this boldness. Philippi had been very difficult for them. They had been, in the words that Acts chapter 17 tells us, describing those events, they'd been severely flogged. It's a life-altering beating that had happened to them. Almost anyone else, for any possible reason, would have decided that they are on the wrong path. This cannot be God's will. This is just wrong. Not only that, he went to Philippi and he began to seek out those that he had the most in common with, those that he had spent his life working among. He began to seek out the Jews. Paul was a Jew. He'd been educated in the highest levels. He was an acknowledged expert in Judaism. And he thought, these are my guys, right? These are my guys. They'll hear this. I can make it so clear to them. We have the scriptures in common. I can show them and tell them that Jesus, who Jesus is, right from their own scriptures. But they're the ones that become Paul's greatest enemies. They're the ones that ultimately chase him out of Thessalonica. Not only do they chase him out of Thessalonica, but they follow him into the next city and make sure he leaves the next city too. But even this opposition, even the threat of death, didn't make him give up. He took the risk to obey God, even though it was dangerous. And that courage, that kind of activity, that kind of living it out comes from God. God's the source of this courage from God that Paul demonstrates. In another letter, he talks about how secure you can be in Christ. He describes what had happened to believers in another city. He said, "For you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God." It's a picture, right? That they identified with Christ's death, and all of a sudden there's nothing else that can happen to them. They are secure in God because of Christ's life in them. In another letter, Paul says this. He says, "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit." That's where it comes from. It's the source. It's the source of his courage. It's the source that you and I can depend on. It demonstrates both courage and, well, influence. Okay, it's the source and the connection, right? Paul illustrates the influence of God also, how he's connected to it into his circumstances. So it makes a difference in how he responds to life each day. It's not just something he's received, it's something he's dependent on. His goal was to please God first. To say, how can I honor God? How can I please him in the choices he makes, the decisions he goes, the people he interacts with? This influence of God kind of shows up in kind of two different ways, one negative and one positive, right? First, he's not greedy. Okay, I know it seems like went from a really high ideal kind of picture to one of these really practical things, right? Paul's not greedy. When you think about it, that's really an important change in how he was living out his faith. All of a sudden, he wasn't doing it to please other people, right? He says it really clearly. We were not trying to please people, but God who tests our hearts. He repeats that kind of idea several times in these verses. He's not greedy. He doesn't use flattery to try and trick people to say, hey, listen to me because you're so great. You know, I really love you. He doesn't make up things. He doesn't choose flattery at the expense of honesty. He tries to tell them the truth. He doesn't make it unnecessarily offensive, but he doesn't shy away from saying, this is who Jesus was. And when you embrace him, it changes every part of your life. He wasn't greedy. He wasn't greedy for men's praise. He wasn't greedy for money, right? Says we didn't put on a mask to cover up greed. He wasn't trying to take advantage of them to make a really good living. In fact, he says to them, while I was with you, I actually worked hard to pay my own way so there would be no confusion about this. Now, Scripture makes it clear that the other apostles or others of the apostles really did make their living from the congregations they served. It was taken pattern of the Jews to support those, to bring a tithe, to bring in their offerings. And it began to influence the way the churches were formed too, so that they did care not only for the needy among them, but make it possible for those who gave leadership time and directed other ministries to not have to work outside of the ministries. But for Paul, he set that right aside. He didn't assert his authority or his right to that kind of thing for them. He wasn't greedy, right? It's another place Paul writes about greed and describes it as a kind of idolatry, right? Your desire for things, for money, for wealth can take God's place in our hearts. Paul, under God's influence, wasn't greedy, right? And he cultivates this. Oh, there's that passage from 1 Thessalonians. He cultivates, I got ahead of myself. There you go. He cultivates a generous spirit. He cultivates a generous spirit. Describes it like this. He said, just as a nursing mother cares for her children, so we cared for you. And he looked out for their best interests. He wanted to provide what they needed in the moment. He wanted to be attentive to the things that, would help them to grow. It's a generous spirit. It was this genuine affection for them. The importance of this shows up all through Paul's writings. In Romans, he says, be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves. Peter echoes it in his letters. He says this. I thought this was pretty crucial in this place. He says, now that you have purified yourself by obeying the truth so that you have sincere love for your brothers, now do it, right? Now love one another deeply from the heart. It's both, right? It's this influence of God in them and a command to live that out for others. It's how the gospel makes an impact, right? It's people who recognize that the message and the messenger are both important. That you need to not only be able to say it, but live it. And to do that, you need to be not only connected to the source, but you need to be under his influence. That connection needs to determine and to be lived out. It needs to be real in our hearts today. So today, I wonder, how's that working for you? Is that a reality in your experience? What kind of impact has the gospel made on you? It begins when you recognize the truth that it's not just true, sort of, but it's true for you, and it gets to set the pattern for your life. You come to a point where all of a sudden the truth of the gospel becomes the central core issue in your life. And how you respond to it in the day becomes a challenge that you live out. You trust God's help to understand those circumstances, what it looks like. So I think Paul would say to us today, look, it's not easy. It's complicated. Your circumstances and your struggles are different from Paul's. But Jesus is the same. Jesus is the same, and you can depend on him. First, you can depend on him to be what he promised to be, the one who loves you and knows what's best for life, the one who died so that he can forgive your sins and to help you to walk each day in ways that honor him. It's both, you see it? It's not just a point in the past, but it's an impact in the present for each one of us. So, Heavenly Father, I thank you. Thank you that your gospel, your good news, your word is powerful. That it can shape. It can bring us into different places. And through our response to you, it can help us too to make an impact in the world around us, in our families, in our workplace, in our neighborhoods. Father, we thank you for that. We thank you for the impact that you intend the gospel to make in each of our hearts and lives. But perhaps you're here today and you've always just held it at arm's length. You've always said, I know the gospel, I hear what you're saying, but just not quite there. Maybe today is that moment where you finally say, okay. Okay. Heavenly Father, I believe it. Today I'm going to trust your work for me. your work to direct my life to be real for me. I want not only to embrace the message, but I want to become those messengers that you shape. I want to know both the source and the connection for my daily life. This begins with first a confession before God who knows you better than you know yourself. The Bible tells us that if we confess our sins, He's faithful. Not only forgives us, but He begins to work in us that which is pleasing to Him. Then we simply invite Jesus in. Say, Lord, that's what I want. I want you to do in me what you promised to do. That's really the reorientation for life that the Bible calls us to. Father, I would pray for those that perhaps even in this moment are making that kind of decision for the very first time. But for others of us, Lord, as we come to face with the gap between where what we know and where we've been and how we live, Lord, again, we just want to embrace that as a reality and ask for a renewal in our lives for a new day, for another day, Father. God, that your gospel can impact us in every way. For your name's sake, I pray. Amen. Let me invite you to take your hymnals. We're going to close with a hymn, and it is number 334. As you're taking your hymns, you'll notice there in the rack in front of you, there's little information cards. And if there's a way I can be an encouragement to you, perhaps to celebrate with you, maybe a new thing that the Lord is doing, you could take one of those information cards, put your name and how to get a hold of you, and I'd love to hear. Perhaps you have a question about what we've said, or about a particular circumstance in your life that you'd like to talk over. You could use that same method. I'll be in the back after the service. You can just hand me the card as you go out the door. We'll see perhaps when we can get together. Maybe I can be an encouragement to you. Well, have you taken your hymnal, found it? It's number 334. Why don't you stand? We're going to sing all four verses as we bring our service to a close.
My life, be thou.